Welcome. In this video, we will discuss about the 15th Finance Commission recommendation. So I have already made a video on 15th Finance Commission or Finance Commission in general, what it is. But just for the little bit of background, so Finance Commission is mentioned in Article 280 of our Constitution. So this is a constitutional body, but it is not a permanent body. Why? Because it has been mandated in the constitution itself that it will be formed every 5 years. By whom? So who's the one who will form this every 5 years? It is the president. So president is the one who will form it every 5 years. And the qualifications and the appointment things are also mentioned in the Lakshmikant book. So I will really advise you guys, go ahead and check it out. This one is important topic. Way back in 2018, mains examination, UPSC has directly asked about the 15th Finance Commission and its recommendation. So in that regard, this topic is important, like over a period of time. At that time it was proposed, now it is being implemented. So all these things become important. Now let's come back to the topic. In this particular video, we will focus more along the line how the vertical and horizontal allocation has been decided. So recently, the government has went ahead with the recommendations of the 15th Finance Commission, and in that there are two important allocation that we need to consider. One is the vertical devolution. What do you mean by vertical devolution? It's like devolution of taxes of the union to state. How the state will get the taxes revenue. So this is how the Finance Commission advised. So Finance Commission is the one who has been mandated under the constitution to divide the taxes. So because most of the taxes are collected by the union and the GST has already been put into place. So in that regard, it is the devolution which is very important, so that the center could transfer the fund to the state to carry out various schemes, activities and other stuff. It has recommended maintaining of vertical devolution of 41%. So just remember, in 14th Finance Commission, it was 42%. What does it mean? That 42% will be given to states. Like if the center has 100% fund, 42% would go to the state according to the 14th Finance Commission. But in 15th Finance Commission, it has been kept as 41. Now, interesting point is, in essence, it is actually the same. So it is at the same level of 42% of the divisive pool. But it is actually the 1% difference that we see is because of the adjustment of the change status of erstwhile state of Jammu and Kashmir into the new union territories of Ladakh and Jammu and Kashmir. So earlier, the J&K was a state, so it used to get a devolution from that. But now, because J&K and Ladakh has become UTs, they are under the care of center itself. So in that regard, the 1% difference that we see is actually the adjustment for that factor. So in essence, it is actually at the same pool level as was the 14th Finance Commission. So we can say there is not much change in how the vertical devolution is happening. In case of horizontal devolution, which is basically the devolution between states. So not all the states are at the same level, like some states are more populous, some states have large area, and other factors are also involved. So in that regard, there has to be a horizontal devolution also. We cannot give the same amount to every state. So for horizontal devolution, it is suggested that 12.5% weightage to demographic performance. So this is the one, 12.5% is according to how the demographic performance of a state had been. 45% would go to income, 15% each to population and area, and 10% to forest and ecology, and finally 2.5% to tax and fiscal effort. So this is how the horizontal devolution, the weightage has been divided. So if you see over here, the maximum weightage has been given to income, and after that population and area. So this is something you should remember. In the upcoming slide, in the next slide, we will also discuss about the various factors related to the horizontal devolution. So let's just quickly go through them. First of all, the population. So it's like population of a state represent the need of the state to undertake the expenditure for providing services to its resident. For an example, UP definitely would require more resources as compared to Sikkim, right? Because of the population, mere population itself, right? So that's it, how one of the criteria according to the horizontal evolution is the population. Next is area. Again, the same thing you can apply. The larger the area, the greater the expenditure requirement for providing comparable service. Again, for large area, you would need more resources. Then there is also a component of forest and ecology. By taking into account the share of dense forest of each state in aggregate dense forest of all state, the share on this criteria is determined. What does it basically mean? Like, for an example, if the 100% dense forest is the hypothetically, let's take an example that the total dense is 100%. In that regard, now we will figure it out which state has what maximum dense forest. So it's like, for an example, we come up that Arunachal Pradesh is the one which has the maximum dense forest. In that regard, the devolution should be more for this as compared to, for an example, Rajasthan, which does not have that much dense forest. So this is how the forest and ecology has been factored in while dividing resources for horizontal devolution. Then there is also a concept of income distance. Listen carefully, what does income distance mean? So income distance is the distance of gross state GDP of a particular state from the state with the highest GSDP. So let's just take a hypothetical situation that the GSDP of Gujarat is highest. So it's highest GSDP, which is gross state domestic product. It is the highest. Now in this comparison, how these states are performing? For example, Maharashtra is almost at par. Then you see the Bihar is actually lagging behind. So this is how it is actually measured. So it is on comparison with the highest GDP. So this will act as a benchmark, and then accordingly the income distance is measured. And hence the one whose income distance is more would require more resources, right? So that the equity among the states can be achieved. Okay, so this is the idea of income distance. And finally, there are also, it is to maintain interstate equity. States with lower capita income would be given a higher share. So we already discussed about it. There are other factors also. For an example, the demographic performance. We saw that 12.5% weightage has been given to demographic performance. What does it mean? It rewards effort made by state in controlling their population. For an example, the southern state. So you know the southern states have worked really hard, like TFR for Tamil Nadu is only 1.6, right? So in that regard, they have really worked hard for the population control. So there has to be some kind of reward for it. So that comes under the demographic performance. This criterion has been computed by using reciprocal of the TFR ratio of each state scaled by 1971 population data. So 1971 population data census was used. This has been done to assuage the fears of the southern state about losing some share in tax transfer due to the reliance on the 2011 census data instead of 1971 census, which could penalize the state that did better on managing demographics. So this is also a thing, like they might get less share because now they have better control on population. So that is why demographic performance was to incentivize the effort. The state with lower TFR will get high score on this criteria. The TFR ratio in a specific year, so let's just quickly see what is exactly TFR. So it is defined as the total number of children that would be born to each woman if she or they were to pass through the childbearing years bearing children according to a current schedule of age-specific fertility rate. So in normal term, just understand TFR is how many child are born out of a woman. So basically how many child can a woman bear during her time when she could be pregnant, that is known as your total fertility rate. So it is considered that the replacement ratio of TFR is 2.1. That it's like there are a couple include two people. So if you are leaving like two, then you are at replacement ratio. So this is your TFR, and TFR is something which is considered like if you states have performed really good in their population control measure, they would be having less population, and we saw population as a criteria. So that is why demographic performance also was taken into consideration. There is also a parameter of tax effort, which is like this criteria has been to reward state with higher tax collection efficiency. So the states which has been able to collect more tax, they would be given some kind of incentive. So this is how, these are the parameter how the horizontal devolution will happen. Just remember them. What are they? They are population, area, then forest and ecology, then demographic performance, as well as your tax efforts. So these are the different criteria which are used for the horizontal devolution. Now let's just quickly also see about the performance based incentive and grants to its state. So basically, because of the performances, there has to be some kind of incentive. So these grants revolve around four main themes. What are those? So the first is social sector, where it has focused on health and education. So it's like health and education, how the performance has been of various states, they will be given grant accordingly. Second is the rural economy, where it is focused on agriculture and maintenance of rural roads. So basically how well the road has been maintained in the rural area, how the agriculture is flourishing in that particular state, that's how those states will get a grant. Rural economies plays a significant role in the country. Now we know that India is an agrarian rural country by its sheer amount of people who live in that area. As it encompasses 2/3 of the country population, 70% of the total workforce and 46% of national income. So a majority of the Indians are in rural areas. So rural economy plays a very important role. Third is the governance and administrative reforms, under which it has recommended grants for judiciary, statistics and aspirational districts and blocks. So this is again something which has been like performance-based incentive, and the grant will be given on the basis of how the performance had been in case of the governance and the administrative reforms. And finally, the fourth theme is the performance-based incentive system for the power sector, which is not linked to grants but provide an important additional borrowing window for a state. So basically, if these states has been able to deal properly with the power sector, efficiently with the power sector, they will not be given any grant, but they would be given a window through which they can get loans from the union. So this is again something which is important. So the performance-based incentive are into four sector: social sector, then rural economy, then your governance and administrative reforms, along with the power sector. So this, just remember these things. So I hope you have understood this video. The homework for you is go ahead and check out the various salient features of the Finance Commission, and at the same time look into the other criticisms associated with the Finance Commission as well. So if you have any doubt, feel free to drop a comment. Thank you.